Good morning. I'm Pastor JV. Welcome to ICA's online service. We're glad you decided to join us today. And before we get started, here's a few things that you might want to know about.
We have ICA Children's Church material available for your kids. You can download it at bit.ly ICA Kids Online. We hope you and your child can have a great experience and encounter God together. Follow ICA Kids on Instagram to get the latest updates from ICA Kids. ICA's prayer service is going stronger on Zoom every Tuesday at 6:30 to 7:30 p.m. You can check our Instagram on Tuesday to get the meeting ID and let us be strengthened by praying together. We provide a new way for you to donate online to the ministry at ICA. You can scan the QR code on the screen or visit icasby.com/giving for more information. Have you followed ICA on our social media or subscribed to ICA's YouTube channel? We've provided devotions, recipes, and more interesting content and updates to accompany you during the quarantine, because physical distancing is not spiritual distancing.
Okay, that's it for announcements. Now worship is about to start, so let's get ready to worship God together all around the world, wherever we are, as one.
Behold the one who's making all things new. We have been redeemed. We have been set free, and you were already. So now our lives, all our voices sing. All creation breathes their adoration for the King who reigns in glory. Behold the one. Deeper than any ocean.
You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is. You are not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is. You are God.
Hey, good morning, ICA. We're glad to have you with us today. This is Pastor JV, and we are going to be talking today about part two of our new series called Foundations, where we talk about the four core values of ICA. And the reason we revisit our four core values every year is to keep us focused on the things that we are meant to be prioritizing as a church body. But even if you're not a part of ICA, these four principles we didn't just make up out of thin air. These are what the Bible says should be the priority for every Christian in their life. So last week we talked about the first of our foundations, which is loving God. And today we're going to talk about our second, which is loving people. There's a danger right away when we say this, because if you've been in the church for a long time, it may be that you've heard this before, love God and love people, and it's easy to tune out right away. But if you hang in here with me, I think that what Scripture talks about as far as loving people and what God's standards are for loving people may be different than what we think about. I mean, it's pretty easy for us to say, yeah, I love people. I'm a good guy. I'm a nice person, you know. People are fine unless I'm stuck in traffic with them, you know. Other than that, I'm good. But we're looking at Scripture and Jesus Christ being our standard for conduct. The goal that we are striving towards. And Jesus prayed for the very people that crucified him. He prayed for God to forgive them. And so, I don't know about you, but that is a little higher level of loving people than I'm at yet. And so, you know, as we look at this, we don't look at it as, hey, yes, we've all arrived here. But we do look at what is the standard that God wants us to strive for. We have a little bit of room to cover. I'm going to try to go fast. If you've heard one of my sermons before, they're not always the shortest. I got punished by our media team by having to put in all my own subtitles last time in the hopes that that will make me talk less. And so we'll see if it worked as we dive in here. So we are going to jump in with where our first pillars come from, which is in Matthew 22, verses 37 through 40. Now, the context is that an expert in the law comes up and asks Jesus a question, and his question is, what is the most important commandment of all the commandments of God? In verse 37, he said, Jesus replied, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And this is what John talked about last week. Verse 39, the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. And in verse 40, this is an important verse. He says, all of the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments. These two commandments. So where are these two commandments from? Well, that first commandment that Jesus quoted is from the Old Testament. It's in a book called Deuteronomy 6, verses 4 through 5, and it says this, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your strength. And this verse was something they called the Shema. Shema in Hebrew means to hear. And it would have been well known by all of the Jews. This was a prayer that would be prayed every morning. By them, every evening, they would pray the Shema on Yom Kippur, their holiest day. It led up to this finale where they would pray the Shema. It was very traditional that when a person was dying, as they neared death, their last words would be the Shema. And so Jesus pointing to the Shema, the Jewish people would have understood that it had value. But he says, not only does it have value, it is the core principle that everything else hangs on. In fact, it is this commandment that is going to set the stage for the second commandment. Because the second commandment, loving people, is going to depend on this first one. It is very hard to pour into others from an empty vessel. And when God asks us to love others, it means that we ourselves need to be filled with love. And so that love for us comes from our relationship to God Himself. And so if you find that it's hard to love other people, I would suggest going back to this first one. Work on that closeness to God. As we are filled with God's presence, it is easier for us to love others. Jesus touches on this in John 15, verses 9 and 12. He says, as the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. My command now is this, love each other as I have loved you. So we see this principle, God loved Christ, Christ loves us. Remain in that love and then we will be able to love others. And so again, if you missed last week, I encourage you go to our YouTube. Check that one out and see in practical ways how we can grow our love for God. It is the key to all of the rest of them. So this second commandment that Jesus said is like the first comes from Leviticus 19, verse 18. And if you read that chapter, it is a long list of things that God says we should do or shouldn't do in relation to other people. It's basically about how we treat others. And then we get to verse 18 where God says, do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against anyone among your people. I mean, we could probably just quit right there. That's enough of a sermon. Don't bear a grudge against anyone. You can think about that. And then he ends with, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. So according to Jesus, if a person does these two things, loves God and loves their neighbor, every other thing that God commands is going to be fulfilled by them through the obedience to these two. Paul emphasizes this in Romans 13, 9, where he says, the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and whatever other command there may be are summed up in this one command, love your neighbor as yourself. Here's the focus. Verse 10, love does no harm to a neighbor. And that is why love is the fulfillment of the law. You see, the law of God is summed up in two things, how we relate to God and how we relate to one another. And the scripture says that if we love one another, we do no harm to each other. We always seek out what is best for others. And by doing so, everything that God has commanded is focused on that. How do we live in such a way that our lives are for the betterment of other people? So if we're going to talk about loving others, we need to know how the Bible defines love. All of us may have our own definitions of love. The world has a definition of love. The Greeks had four different words for love, each with their own definition. So we want to know how Scripture defines love. And I think one of the most beautiful passages of Scripture is this definition that is given in Paul's letter to the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. We're going to read it. It is also one of the most maybe sobering or challenging verses as well in what it demands of us. 1 Corinthians 13 chapter 1 says this, if I speak in the languages of men or of angels, but I do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and I can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but I do not have love, I am nothing. If I give everything I possess to the poor and I give over my body to hardship so that I may boast, but I do not have love, I gain nothing. So right away, this should bother us a little bit. I mean, this is really sobering because it means that many of the things that we do in life, if we are missing this key element, in the end, will have lost their value in the eyes of God. So then Paul begins to define what this love is that we need to have. He says, love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. That means it doesn't hold grudges. It is not unforgiving. We'll talk about that later. Verse 6, love does not delight in evil, but it rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. It always perseveres. Love never fails. And then as Paul continues, he's going to talk about how everything else in the world will someday cease. Knowledge will pass away. Languages will pass away. Prophecies will be fulfilled. But when we stand before God, there will only be a few things that truly remain. In verse 13, he says, so these three things remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. According to Paul, love is the key principle or value of Christianity. And if we don't have it, everything else about our actions and our deeds and our faith and our knowledge loses its meaning. Jesus agrees with this. In fact, in John chapter 13, Jesus says that love is the true sign that somebody is a follower of Jesus Christ. Now, there's a lot of things Jesus could have said would be a sign for how somebody can know you are a Christian. But in talking to his disciples, Jesus says this in verse 34, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another." Notice that Jesus raises the bar again. It goes from love your neighbor as you love yourself to now, as I have loved you, love one another. Verse 35, "By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another." You know, the church, the thing we could ask ourselves is this how people know that we are followers of Jesus Christ? When people think of Christians, is it this? Or is it people that don't do this or people that don't do that thing? Is it people that simply attend church and sit in a chair, wear a certain type of clothes? I mean, what is the definition of a Christian? Because according to Jesus, by this one thing will people know you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Loving God and loving one another are the two signs that our Christian faith is healthy. We will be known by our love. Now, Scripture says that the people of the world will also be known by the things that they love. And so as we evaluate our Christian faith, we can ask ourselves, what do I love? In 2 Timothy chapter 3, Paul warns about the way that the world will be in the future and what people will love. It says this in verse 1, "Mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God." This is Paul's description of the generation that will exist in the last days. And you can notice that rather than loving God and loving others, their focus is on loving themselves, loving things, and loving pleasure. In a world that treats things as valuable and people as objects to be used, we as Christians have to be different. And so the Bible says there is a differentiation between Christians and our values and the world. The other thing the Bible warns us about our love is that it has to be tended. Love is a thing in our life that if we're not careful can grow cold. Matthew 24:12 says that in the last days, because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most people will grow cold. This is a warning to us that our love can grow cold. In Revelations chapter 2, verses 2 and 4, God is speaking to the church in Ephesus, and he praises them for many of the things that they do, but he has one criticism. He says, "I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, and that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and you have found them false." So he praises them for the fact that they have good, sound doctrine, that their teaching is correct, that their belief is accurate and right. But he has this criticism. "I hold this against you," he says in verse 4. "You have forsaken the love you had at first." You know, church, the Bible says that our love can grow cold. And so again, this goes back to, what is the solution if our love grows cold? Well, you know, where I'm from, it can get really cold. And I remember we would have a fire in our house. And so the closer you got to the fire, you'd be protected from that cold, because the warmth of the fire protected you from being changed by the temperature of the outside world. Here in Indonesia, I think it would be the other way around. The outside world changes our body temperature, But if we go and stand by the AC, suddenly the AC restores us to where we want to be. And so as our love grows cold from time in this world of dealing with wickedness and hardship and struggles, it is so important for us to go to God, get filled up again in our spirit by God, so that we have His love to pour out to other people. So if you looked at what love is, we're going to touch really quickly on some practical things of what love does and how we know it's at work in our lives. The first thing is that love acts. Love is not just a feeling in our heart. If love is there, it needs to be shown in what we do. I know that there's a fire somewhere because I feel its heat and I see the light that comes from it. We know that there's love in our lives because we see it lived out through the things that we do. In 1 John 3:17 and 18, the Apostle John says, "If anybody has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person?" Verse 18, "Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth." So this is the first thing about love when we examine our lives. It's not enough simply to say, do I feel good about other people? What am I doing in my life for others? That is the sign that love is in my heart. In fact, it is so important that Jesus gave an entire parable about what it will be like at the end day when all nations stand before God and are judged. And it's interesting because he focuses on the acts of their lives based on the love that is in their heart or that is not in their heart. This is in Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 through 46. In verse 31 through 33, he basically says that when he comes, he will separate the peoples of the world before him, like a shepherd separates the sheep and the goats. And it says in verse 34, "Then the king will say to those on his right, 'Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me.' Then the righteous will answer him, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?' I'm pretty sure I would have remembered that, Lord." Verse 40, "The king will reply, 'Truly I say to you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did for me.'" Verse 41, "Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, but you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me.' And they also will answer, 'Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you?' And he will reply, 'Truly, I tell you, whatever you did not do for the least of these, you did not do for me.'" Our love is shown by our deeds and actions in this world. If we find that we are not doing good towards others, we need to examine our hearts, ask God to search us and see, has our love, like the Ephesians church, grown cold? Another thing that love does is it forgives. Remember, this verse comes from Leviticus 19:18. The very beginning of that verse is, "Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against anyone among your people. But love your neighbor as yourself. Colossians 3:13 says, bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. So this is the key here, is God comes back in the area of forgiveness all the time to the fact that we come to Him for forgiveness. We come to God and we are hoping that He will forgive us. This is why Scripture says to love others as we love ourselves. There is one person in your life that you always hope the best for. There's one person that no matter how many mistakes they make, you still hope that they will get their life together, that they will turn out all right, that they will end up being the best person they can be. And that is ourself. When we come to God, even though we've done wrong, we are hoping He will forgive us and we are hoping that He will help us to be better. God is simply saying to us, we need to do the same for others. Now, this can be hard. There are various levels of wrongs that people do against us. Some of you have been deeply wronged by others. I want to say that forgiveness is not saying that what somebody else did isn't wrong or that it wasn't a big deal or that I should just let it go. Forgiveness does not even mean that you have to be around people that are bad or toxic or destructive in your life. Forgiveness merely means that you would rather that person change their ways, be transformed by God into what they were intended to be, that you would rather that happen than see them face judgment. Because that is the same desire for ourselves. We desire in our own life that we would change and be better rather than be judged. And God is saying, have that same hope and desire for others. Another thing about love is that love is honest. Now, we've all heard that Scripture says that we should not judge, and this is a part of love. God has not called us to be those that pass judgment on other people. And it should not be our desire that other people face punishment for the things that they've done. But we have to understand what that means, because this can get twisted around into being said that we can't tell people that sin is sin. Not judging doesn't mean that we don't judge that certain actions are sinful or wicked and that certain actions are right. Of course we're going to judge that. We're going to judge that in ourselves. We should be looking inward all the time and judging whether or not certain things that I'm doing are right or wrong so that I can change. God, in fact, calls us to point out things that are right and wrong. What judging means is to not be the person that executes the sentence. It's not my job to punish somebody for their wrongs. But it is my job to warn people when they do wrong. Love is honest. Leviticus 19:17 says, do not hate a fellow Israelite in your heart, but rebuke your neighbor frankly so you will not share in their guilt. So in the same verse, it's saying, don't hate others. It's also saying, but you need to warn them when they do wrong. Otherwise, you will share in their guilt. Scripture says that we are called to warn people when they are on a bad road. If we don't, they will continue down that bad road, but God will hold us responsible for not warning them. If I see a person driving down the road and I know that there's a bridge out and that they're going to fall to their death, you know, if I don't say anything, I'm responsible for what happens to them. And if I sit there and go, well, I didn't want to disturb them and mess up their beautiful drive by giving them the bad news that they're heading in a bad direction, I am not walking in love. No loving parent whose child is about to stick their finger in a light socket says, hey, I can't judge that behavior. You know, of course, we're going to warn people when things are wrong. It is our job in love to be honest with other people about what is good, what is bad, what is right, and what is wrong. Especially in our world today, where the values of our world now are changing dramatically, where people are calling good evil and evil good, it is not a time for us to be silent about the values of God and what He stands for. In James 5:19 through 20, it says, my brothers and sisters, if one of you should wander from the truth and someone should bring that person back, remember this, whoever turns a sinner from the error of their ways will save them from death and cover over a multitude of sins. So the next thing we want to look at is that love protects. In Romans 14, verse 13, it says, "Let us stop passing judgment on one another. Instead, make up your mind not to put any stumbling block or obstacle in the way of a brother or a sister." So love is protective. You know, a father is protective over his household. A mother is protective of their children. It should be instinctual in love to protect others. But this also means that we need to protect other people in our own lives by our actions, our influence, and our behaviors with them. You know, in the story of Genesis, Cain, who murdered his own brother, his answer to God is, "Am I my brother's keeper?" There can be this mindset that I am not responsible for what happens to others. But that is not part of love. Walking in love means that I will protect. One example of this might be in relationships. If we find that we are attracted to somebody, we're dating somebody, it's natural for us to want to be close to them. But if we allow our emotional desires or our physical desires to cause ourselves to begin to tempt somebody to maybe push boundaries, to do things that we know are wrong, we are no longer walking in love, no matter how much we may feel like love is the motivator. You know, loving our own self and our own desires and our own passions is not love. Love, it protects. Love makes sure that we are guarding the integrity of that other person. You know, this can go into everything in our lives, how we conduct ourselves, how we treat other people, what we post on social media, how we dress. The question we have to ask is, am I trying to entice people? Am I trying to instill desire in them, maybe towards me with the things that I post on social media? Do I make people stumble by the things that I approve? Or am I interested in how my life impacts the lives of other people? If we're walking in love, we are trying to live a life that is not spiritually harmful to others. So as we start wrapping this up, we have all the stuff about what love is and what love is requiring of us. Now, the guy who's talking to Jesus, you know, hears these and he wants to know if there's an out for him. You know, who exactly do I have to do this towards? And so he asks this question, well, okay, I got to love my neighbor. Who's my neighbor? And I won't go into the fullness of Jesus' answer. You can read it in that scripture, but the gist of it is, Jesus' reply is that neighbor is not something that somebody else has to become. It is something that we make ourselves. We have to decide to be a neighbor to others. And so the love that we are to give is to be to everyone that we encounter. In fact, Jesus ups the ante and goes even further. In Luke chapter 6, 27 through 36, he says, "But to you who are listening, I say..." So he's already said, love our neighbors as ourselves. Then he raises it up and he says, now love each other as I have loved you. Well, Jesus gave his own life for us. So now that standard's even higher. And now he really drops it on us in Luke chapter 6, verse 27. He says, "To you who are listening, I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. And pray even for those who mistreat you." In verse 32, "If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do that. But love your enemies, do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back, and then your reward will be great. For you will be children of the Most High, because He is kind to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful." So this second commandment, the second foundation of loving each other, is the core principle of all of our interaction with one another. And the bar that God has set is high. And I do not expect that all of us right out of the starting gate will be able to succeed at this, but this is what we aim for. And so as we walk in our life, let's keep in mind the example of Jesus Christ that he not only loved those that loved him, but he came and gave his life for those that hated him. You know, at ICA, we have a department that is our missions department. And so through our missions department is one of the ways that we, as a corporate church community, show love outside of our walls to our community. And so I want to pause for a second, and we're going to go to Wijaya, who is our missions director, to talk a little bit about some of the things that ICA has been doing, even during the time of COVID, to show the love of God to our community.
Hi, I'm Wijaya, ICA missions director. 2020 has been a challenging year for many of us. At ICA missions, it is still an opportunity to serve others in times of need. One of the first things we did was a rapid response to the COVID outbreak by providing hundreds of hazmat safety suits and masks to the local hospitals and community at the beginning of the outbreak. Volunteers at ICA worked to sew and make masks at the time when hospitals were short on needed supplies. We have also been able to provide relief packages to around 5,000 families in Surabaya through our social ministry at Sambisari, as well as throughout other parts of Indonesia, from Sumatra to Papua, that have been affected by the outbreak. In addition, we have been continuing to scholarship students to university who might not otherwise be able to go, to give them opportunity for a bright future. We are looking forward to partnering with you in 2021 to continue to show God's love through service. Thanks, ICA.
So as we close, I want to say, whatever our talent or our ability or our position in life, wherever God has placed you, if you can love others, you can make God known by your love, and you are doing the thing that God says is the most important thing for us to be doing in this life. As we go into 2021, let us endeavor to be a people who are known by our love. Let's pray. Lord, as we look at your scripture and we look at the challenge to what you have called us to, we know, God, that you do not simply ask us to do something, but not empower us to do it. Jesus, you came and you showed the way through your own life. And we know that if we are to love others, it is going to be because you love us first. As we focus on that first pillar, loving you and being with you and being recharged by you, that God, your spirit has all the love that we need to be able to love others. And so, Lord, as a church, maybe in our life we've gotten busy, God. Maybe we've gotten distracted. Maybe we've gotten worn down by hardship and difficulty and stress and some of the wickedness in the world. Lord, if that is us, if that is someone out there right now, I pray, God, that you would just draw us back to you. You would help us to step away and to get re-plugged into you, Lord, so we can be filled with you again, so that from you we have the ability to love others. So, Lord, today I pray for your blessing to be on everybody who's at home and who's watching. And God, as we go out into this world, that we'd be a people that are known by our love. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you guys. Have a fantastic week. And we'll see you here again next week.
There's a space in every beating heart. There's a longing that reaches past the stars. There's an answer to every question mark. There's a name. There's a hope flowing through these veins. There's a voice that echoes through the pain. There's an ember ready for the flame. There's a name. We will fix our eyes.
Changes that matter.